The question is if Obamacare goes away, will the federal match on Medicaid change? Right now, there's talking about maybe block grants for Medicaid to the states, but the dollar for dollar is not from Obamacare. It's the traditional program that existed before. Now, the expansion population, that might be affected, but it depends what gets passed. So we're watching this kind of every day and getting updates from people who monitor it for us. Yeah. Okay, so we add everything up and we're at 979 million, and you can see the next number down is lower than that. The amount of new money we expect to have available. So we have to find a way to close a $558 million budget gap. Congratulations on joining the state senate. So our budget proposal that you see kind of out there now has all the different ways that we're closing this gap. So leaving this alone, autopilot, is just not going to work. We will run out of money, and we're not allowed to deficit spend in the state. All right. Okay. So we talked about how we have more money than we can keep. And so this is a complicated way of showing it. But this is all the money the state collects, not just our general fund. And we've made a special color for this thing called the hospital provider fee. Now, we have a limit that we can keep in the state, and it was set by the voters in a ballot issue called Referendum C in 2005. And so there was a 5-year timeout from the Tabor Law, and the high point of that year, of the 5-year period, the high point was the new base year. And then that gets adjusted, population plus inflation, forever. So you can see where the line starts, at 2007, 2008. And then you can see the yellow where this thing called the hospital provider fee starts being collected by the state. When the state implemented the program, I didn't work there at the time. they counted it under the cap. There was a way to do it, and there still is a way to count it outside the cap. But it's crowding out our ability to get the bounce back in the economy and spend the money on our existing stuff, like roads, schools, Medicaid, keeping tuition down. Since we're in a higher education building, that matters. So right now, we're above the limit, and this hospital fee is restricted on what we can use it for. So if you remember one slide ago, we're collecting the hospital fee in one pot of money, but we have to pay it back out of the general fund where it's not collected. And if that didn't make sense to you, it means you were listening. It's just the rule. It's just how the rule works. Another pot of money is driving a liability in the general fund. So we have a proposal to get rid of that. We've been fighting over it for 2 years, but we can't get it through the state senate. Okay, so we'll go quickly through the next ones. Next. Okay, so again, where we spend most of our time is the state general fund. So this is where we spend income and sales taxes. And we can go around and see kind of the main issues. Our biggest responsibility in the state is to finance K-12 education. And what isn't generated by local property taxes, the state fills in from the state general fund. Now, if you've been following state finances really closely, there's a change in property tax law that just happened, where a complicated law called the Gallagher Amendment, which tries to keep the burden of property taxes on businesses higher than on homeowners, is the values are bouncing around, and so to keep the ratios where they're supposed to be in the Constitution, we're going to lower residential property taxes. Great news, right? Okay. Except the amount that the Constitution says I have to pay for schools just went up by $100 million. So unless new money comes in to help pay the pie slices, I have to take the money from other pie slices. Saw a hand go up.
Yeah. I mean, didn't this past election, they passed school increase in taxes for the schools?
So there may have been through when?
Greasy and Aurora?
Yeah, so now that probably was called an override mill levy. And so Aurora School District gets to keep that money, but it doesn't come into this formula. And with the new lower residential assessment rate from Gallagher, it might not generate the money that people thought they voted for. Complicated. It's, yeah.
And what is the hospital provider fee?
What do we do with the hospital? Great question. Okay.
Just, Lewis, to clarify your question, I'm guessing most, although not everybody here, lives in either Aurora Public Schools or Cherry Creek Schools, here in Adams County and maybe in a different district. But to the last issue here about local versus state funding for education, if you are in APS, you had a question on your ballot 3C, that was bonds for Aurora Schools. That's not ongoing things like teacher salaries, that's just capital construction. Aurora has grown by 7,000 or 8,000 students since the last time that there was a bond. New money was needed to rehab some schools, improve safety, build some new buildings. If you were in Cherry Creek Schools, which is south of here, roughly speaking, you saw 3A and 3B, and that was a bond and also an operating expense question. We have a member of the Cherry Creek School Board here. Perhaps later on you can say a bit more about that. All this goes to the local aspect of schooling. Personally, I'm glad that we passed 3C for Aurora. I think it'll help the kids. However, that doesn't send any money to the state, and it doesn't fix these other issues that Henry's talking about with state funding. So back to Henry.
Perfect. Thank you for that. What is the hospital provider fee? There is a program through the federal government where you're allowed to get money other than general taxes, specifically from healthcare providers. And the federal government will match it for enhancements to the program of Medicaid. So, in 2009, the hospital trade group and some other healthcare advocates realized that we weren't drawing down as much federal funds as we could. So, the mechanism is they pay a fee based on how many patients they serve, basically, to the state. We demonstrate that money to the federal government, and then they match that dollar for dollar. We can only spend all that total new pot of money on either expansion of Medicaid, so this is paying for the expanded Medicaid, or paying providers a higher reimbursement rate for the services they do for the public. So it's a specialized kind of stream of revenue. It's not general taxes. And it's counting towards the whole limit of the state. Okay? Appreciate your question. Okay, so back to the pie slices. Again, our number one responsibility is K-12 education. And then the voters put keeping up with enrollment and inflation in the Constitution, even if we don't have the money to pay for it. A lot of times I do these talks to business groups and they say, you guys should run more like a business. So you've never heard of a business that runs this way because they're out of business. When you can't control your revenue or your expenses, it's really hard to manage me. Okay, so the Medicaid program on this slice is only the original Medicaid. It's not the expanded Medicaid. The expanded Medicaid for the moment is paid for by the federal government and hospital provider. So, this is pre-Obamacare. We are in charge of about 20,000 prisoners, and then a court system. That's public safety and courts. The human services slice doesn't get a lot of attention, except when you hear these horrible stories in the newspapers. So that's child welfare, it's mental health, developmental disabilities, and the Division of Youth Corrections. Higher education, again, it's timely that we're here. So we support keeping tuition down for about 155,000 resident students in Colorado. It's the only big meaningful slice on here that is not a constitutional mandate or a federal mandate. So when we have budget problems, that's the place we go. And then we take money away and then we complain about the schools raising tuition. Well, there's only two pots of money to pay for buildings like this and to have teachers. It's support from the state or tuition and fees. It's a pretty simple equation. Now, in that other slice where it says other, that's every other department that gets money from the general fund, including A subject that I'm sure is on some people's mind. Gentleman walked in with me today on the way in, the senior homestead exemption. So in 2000, the voters were asked to put this thing in the Constitution where we exempt up to $200,000 of home value from property taxes for qualifying seniors. But they also said you're allowed to adjust it all the way down to zero. The state has done that before when we've had the last two recessions. Now, with the property tax rate for all residential homeowners dropping unexpectedly from the Gallagher change, we've proposed reducing that in half to backfill so we can pay for schools, as well as raising the marijuana sales tax rate. So hopefully this will help explain why. All right, now, pretty small, sir.
Well, one of the things that I see the public safety and these folks know me, I retired from the Department of Corrections.
You did?
And
what did you do?
I was an officer.
Okay.
And I worked with high security inmates. But there were 9 items that I presented, Morgan Carroll, and to even the warden, about cutting the cost in corrections to save taxpayers a lot of money that can go into the school system. Of course, I was ignored because I'm not a politician. But there are things in corrections that I know can be cut and save thousands and thousands of dollars.
And get to millions and millions?
What?
Do they get to millions and millions?
We're all for thousands and thousands. So if you have ideas, I'd love to hear about them. I'll give you my email when I leave tonight. I'm always up for that. Sir, or ma'am, excuse me. So the state assistance, the local library line, is that the issue? Do I support cutting it? I'm not sure. We didn't support cutting it. And if we ever got in a pinch, I will tell you, when I came back to state government, it was right around the Great Recession at the bottom.
The revenue that was promised, has it come in?
We're above the original projections.
You're above the original.
Yeah, and the money earmarked for schools, you have to realize, was earmarked for school construction. And that's on the excise tax. It's on the wholesale tax of marijuana.
Now, who's paying for all this advertising to have our kids not use it?
The state is mostly funding that.
From where?
Coming out of marijuana taxes.
For education.
So whatever marijuana.
No. We're not taking away from education.
No. That's what I'm saying. Education about marijuana.
Yes. It's a public information campaign. Correct. Sorry. So your general taxes aren't going to those commercials. It's the people who buy marijuana. They pay a pretty high sales tax. And we use that money to pay for these education campaigns the regulation, most of the regulation is paid for with the licensing fees that the businesses pay.
Okay, let me ask you this. If we didn't pass that marijuana issue, we wouldn't have this issue.
I don't understand that question. If we didn't pass marijuana, we wouldn't have what?
What?
No one would be smoking marijuana. I don't think that's how that works.
The need to educate kids about not using marijuana.
You probably have that
anyway. So
we didn't have it before 64.
So we have data before and after 64. It's called the Healthy Kids Survey. And it's bounced around the same amount of usage for kids using marijuana. We want to get that number lower, but we're very happy that it hasn't spiked. I don't think people started using just after it became legal.
A lot more.
Please. Awesome. The question is concurrent enrollment. Are you a concurrent enrollment student?
I teach.
Oh, you teach. Okay, great. You look young. Everyone looks young to me now. I'm getting old. So the way concurrent enrollment works, it's through the K-12 program where they form an alliance with the local college. I saw the signs on the way in. There's a concurrent enrollment booth in the main office here. The money for that is in the blue slice. Okay, now. Okay, that was it. I want to say a little bit about transportation, and then you all might have your program to follow, right? Who knows the primary way we pay for roads?
Gas tax.
Gas tax. All right. For extra credit, what's the unleaded gas tax amount?
26 cents something.
Close. 22 cents a gallon.
That's good.
Guess what it was in 1992? 22 cents a gallon. Does your car now, if you even had a car, some of you, in 1992, get the same gas mileage as it does now? No. It's like the Honda CRX. Remember
that
thing?
That's right.
50 miles a gallon in 1980 something. Yeah. So how many of you also think that the cost of concrete and asphalt is the same as in 1992? Yeah. So our gas tax is per gallon, and our cars go farther per gallon than they ever have before, and some cars are electric. That's not fair. And they still use the roads, so we charge them a higher registration fee. But that still has to change a little bit. One second. Okay. Thank you. Inflation in construction plus gas fuel efficiency, and we still have 22 cents a gallon. So our budget, and by the way, that 22 cents a gallon is protected by the Constitution for transportation. I can't siphon it off to help pay for this stuff over here in the general fund, which is great. You know exactly where that money's going. It's protected for roads. But over time, 22 cents buys less and less and less. And now our CDOT budget is pretty much just maintaining the busiest roads that we have. In rural parts of the state, we don't plow the snow overnight if it snows. And there's a big sign you can drive by and say, if it's snowing, just know we're not plowing the road till daylight, till the new shift starts. Some rural roads are going to gravel. So we're focusing on the busiest highways, which we should. But last year, 100,000 new people moved to Colorado. Probably the same amount will happen again this year. And our transportation system isn't keeping up. So this year, probably in addition to schools, which has been more of a surprise issue, some attention on transportation is going to need some engagement from the public so that the legislators understand what you might be willing to approve at the ballot. Because we're not going to get out of this by raising registration fees. We can't. We can't raise the gas tax without a vote of the people. And so it's going to have to be a ballot issue. So if the transportation system is not giving you what you want. It's because nothing's changed since 1992 for the main source of financing for transportation. So, you had your hand up throughout the whole thing.
So we did raise the registration fee several years ago.
Yes.
And it has come down. And from what I understood, it was only going to be temporary and then disappear. My registration doubled, so where's all that money?
So that's called FASTER. That was 2009. And that was a new registration fee based on cars. So there's a component that goes to bridges, and we've taken care of almost every suboptimal bridge. I forget the engineering term. Deficient, it's some funky word that makes you scared. So most of those bridges are done. The biggest remaining one we're all aware of is the viaduct. And as soon as we're past all the lawsuits and the approvals, that some of that FASTER money is gonna fix the viaduct. The rest goes into just kind of asphalt and potholes and regular maintenance. When they studied the issue before that law passed, the annual shortfall in just maintenance was $500 million, and that law generated about $150 million. So we're still falling behind on maintenance, and we're not able to do any expansion with the budget we have. So yes, that $40 you're paying stung, and I'm sure it was a big change, especially if you have an older car, from year to year. If you have a newer car, some of what you paid wasn't to the state. It's a property tax on your car called specific ownership tax, and that goes to help pay for schools.
Another question.
And then we'll turn
it over. Is there any way, and I suggested it a while back to Morgan Carroll, about doing away with the state income tax and go to a consumption tax where everybody will pay the pimps, the pushers, prostitutes, everyone will pay that to raise revenue, because many people are not paying state income tax.
Let's see. So this is our general fund. That's where income taxes go, and also our state sales tax. So about 2/3 of the money that goes to this is from income taxes. And about 1/3 is the sales tax, and then there's other, like there's an insurance tax, and there's a couple other taxes that go in here, but 2/3, 1/3. So to raise the sales tax that high, I think would be really hard on the lower end of the economic spectrum. I think to replace, because right now it's, you know, like maybe $2 billion. In sales taxes?
Well, if you didn't want to pay a higher sales tax, don't buy that Mercedes. Buy yourself an old Volkswagen.
Yeah. Actually, what you're bringing up is this debate of should you tax income or should you tax consumption. You know, pointing at an economist like me, this is what we get excited over at drinks on Fridays. Like, how could you design the perfect tax? You know, it incentivizes right behavior, it disincentivizes bad behavior, is fair, generates what you need to pay for what you want, all that stuff. And so where Colorado is relative to other states, we've got one of the lower income taxes of states with an income tax. We have one of the lower sales taxes, but we have higher local taxes. A state like Texas, no income tax, but man, do they get you on property taxes. And so it all evens out.
I have one question.
Sure.
I do the I-70 corridor.
Yeah.
And all those trucks, and like the road was closed twice when I was up there.
Right.
There were hundreds of trucks there.
Yeah.
And when you're coming through, they have to put chains on. And when you're coming through, especially on the right side, the road is already being tore up. And they just, so who pays? See, that's a lot of extra maintenance. Now,
yeah.
Is the state covering all of that, or does the federal government, because it's an interstate?
So next time you fill up your car, look on the little tag on the gas pump. There's the 22 cents, unless you have a diesel car. And then there's 18.3 or 4 cents federal tax. So we pay that to the feds, something magic happens, and then we get it back. And so it's typically earmarked. Now, I-70 is a federal highway, so we share the cost of I-70. There are special registration fees on trucks, and the trucks that aren't registered here but drive through here, we have an agreement with other states to share that money. So everybody pays a little bit to pay for ISIP.
Because we are getting, Colorado's hit really high. A lot of those trucks are going through to other places.
Yep.
And our roads are being eaten up.
I agree with you. And so the way we try to manage that is they pay their own registration fees, they pay diesel tax on their gasoline, and then we share among the states. Sometimes they'll fill up at the border and then drop, you know what I mean?
A lot of those trucks have plates from states with lower taxes.
Yeah.
And you see those plates all the time coming through.
True.
So we're not going to send him away, Director Simonet. You can stay here, but I'm going to ask my colleagues to come sit up at the table. And I saw your hand, and I'm going to come to you, but we're going to have you sit up at the table. I'm going to come to you with the microphone. And Director Sauvignon will stand there. Before I come to get your question, if you all could just introduce yourselves, have a seat. I'll sit at the end when we're done. Okay, go ahead. Senator Fields, you can start, introduce yourself and your district and area, et cetera.
Thank you, Representative, and congratulations once again on winning the race. I'm State Senate for Senate District 29, that starts at Colfax and Yosemite, goes all the way down the I-70 corridor, which includes Buckley, of course, the Aurora Town Center, Saddle Rock, Southlands, Heritage Bend, Watkins, Strasburg, Bennett, Byer. So it goes in Deer Trail. So I serve in the Senate, and I'm serving on two committees. I serve on Judiciary and Agriculture.
Hi everybody, my name is Dominique Jackson. I am your state representative from House District 42. That is, yay, we got some cheers. That is north central Aurora, so right out near Chambers, down to Colfax, over to the Denver border, and as far south as Jewell. I serve on, guess what? Transportation. Woo-hoo! And energy. So yes, we have a lot of work that we're gonna be doing this year. One of the other committees that I serve on is also gonna be a big, heavy lift, I would say, this legislative session, and that is health insurance and environment. As a lot of you know, there are talks about some changes to the Affordable Care Act, some issues with potential issues with some Medicaid funding. So we're going to have a lot of work to do this legislative session.
And I'm Mike Weissman, State Representative for House District 36. We are in 36 right now. So I'm three of the four of us up here are brand new, and Senator Fields is new in her position, having moved to the Senate from the House. If Sue Ryden was formerly your representative, I'm your representative now. The district is roughly Chambers Road east past the tollway all the way to the very edge of the city, and from Colfax in the north south to Smoky Hill. So some of the older neighborhoods like where we are now, also some of the newer neighborhoods all the way down to Tolkien Crossing and Sorrel Ranch. The fairgrounds, the Southlands Mall, the Big Aurora Reservoir are in the southern end of 36. I'll be serving this year on the Judiciary and State Affairs Committees. Judiciary hears things like probate issues a lot of the time, criminal justice, policing reforms. Tends to be a pretty high volume committee in terms of bills that go through there. State Affairs for short, or State Veterans and Military Affairs, hears things concerning, as the name suggests, Department of Military Affairs issues, for example, the plan to try to get Veterans Home up on the Fitzsimmons campus next to the VA hospital that's being built is under the jurisdiction of that committee. A lot of things related to how we run elections in Colorado at the state level. Campaign finance reform, trying to bring more transparency to who's spending money in our elections also goes there. I was checking today, and actually of all the bills introduced in the House, 40% of them are going to one of those two committees or the other. So I'm in for some long nights, but I like coffee, so it's okay.
Hello, I am Representative Daphna Michaelson Jenet, and I have all of the Adams County part of Aurora. So I start at Colfax, and I go all the way north up to Thornton, I go east to Bennett, Kingsburg, and Strasburg, and I go west to the border of Denver, but entirely in Adams County, and have a pretty hefty chunk of Aurora. I have walked every square mile of it. And I am on the Finance Committee, and I am on the Public Health and Human Services Committee. So in Public Health and Human Services, we are paying very close attention to how we make sure to keep Coloradans covered and how we continue to operate our state while we're doing so. And in finance, the presentation you just got from Director Chauvenet, we just got as well. So I could use it about 3 or 4 more times. I don't know about you. There are a lot of very specific nuances, and as we try to figure out how do we cover that shortfall, we will also have some very long nights with a lot of coffee. So Luke here from the community college has offered to play microphone runner, and we wanted to open it up where you can ask questions, bless you, where you can ask questions of Director Chauvenet, which I believe the gentleman in the blue in the back there had a question, but you should also feel free to ask any one of us questions as well.
This is a question for the director, all of what we were just talking about. With.
Oh, hi, okay.
Hey, I'm David. I wanted to ask, I moved here in 2011, lived in other states, and getting to
work,
yeah, I lived in Virginia, Georgia, Pennsylvania, a lot of different places. Has this state ever had car inspections? Because I know in Virginia and Pennsylvania, that's a big deal, and you do have to pay for those. And I don't think that they consider that as a tax as much as it is a revenue builder for other things. In Virginia, there was also a car tax, which Bernie down here mentioned, if you own a Mercedes, you might end up paying about $1,200 on that. There's actually Democrats in Virginia who ran against the new car tax in 2004 and 2005. But that was a big revenue builder for schools, for other things. So I understand Tabor handicaps a lot of that, but has there been anything regarding the vehicles themselves that been put in place?
Great question. So let me answer a little bit generally. So the main point you're asking for about emissions inspections?
Emissions or mechanical.
Safety, like New York has.
Okay.
Safety.
Yeah. Our inspection program is every other year after a certain. So if you buy a new car, you have an exemption for 3 or 4 years on your emissions. After that, it's every other year to register. It's 5 years? Okay, thank you. So new cars, 5 years, and then every other year after that. And then you can't renew until you get the tailpipe test. So that's really just a clean air program, and we don't generate above the clean air. It's not a way to just generate road taxes. The registration fee, Lewis, I just met Lewis, was talking about, that's the latest revenue raising item for the state, again, 2009, and that's earmarked for bridges and basically pavement. Ed,
yeah.
Nice to meet you earlier.
Right. We did have, in Colorado, we did have safety inspections prior to when emissions inspections kicked in. And when emissions inspections started, like 25 or 30 years ago, whatever, at that point they just simply dropped the safety inspections.
All my knowledge is like personal experience since 1986. So before that, I'm relying on our longer tenured citizens. Yeah.
In the early 80s, we still had emissions.
Yeah.
Inspections, on safety inspections.
Got it.
And they were very good. I mean, they looked at the tire tread and your lights, you know, broken taillights or whatever, everything.
Basically,
I'm
kind of a garage.
Right. I think now that most of that stuff, broken taillights, tires, you know, there's a tire tread law on I-70 now. You know, if you have a broken taillight, the police will pull you over. Again, asking people to come and get their car inspected. Where we are now is it's every other year, unless you have a new car.
Director, can you explain to us how the governor's recommendation is going to influence that pie chart? Because as you know, he has made some recommendations, and if you could just highlight for the folks here what his recommendations are.
Sure.
And how you think we're going to be able to meet that need.
Great question. So let's walk through this chart, which is the gap chart, and how did we close it? So new enrollment and inflation, we have proposed not growing by the full amount. And so the budget request has, of the 243, we're gonna do about 200 of it. That, again, that all depends on what happens on this mill levy deal. So if the mill levy drop doesn't get backfilled by the two ideas that we proposed this week, the 200 million may not happen. So let's hold that off to the side, like we said before. The Tabor rebate, 195 million of that. The way we're handling that is we are limiting the natural growth of the hospital provider fee to 195 million below what they would normally collect. So the yellow there goes right to the tippy top of the line, and then we don't have a rebate under the old forecast of this. Now, 195 is not 224. So there's going to be a small Tabor rebate in the budget as we left it. But to pay for that, we've transferred in some other money from severance taxes. The general fund has helped out the severance tax budget the last year to the tune of over $100 million. So we're asking the severance tax money that's gonna come in next year to pay us back. We're repaying the budget reserve, so that's we made room for that. Transportation and capital, we're not gonna do this full amount. So in the budget year we have now, this is next year, that line item is 158 million. So what we're going to do is chop this year's money in half and zero out the 164. Makes us popular. So we're gonna spend the 79 million that we saved this year, we'll save it next year. Again, the general fund only helps transportation when it has kind of quote in quotation extra money. Most of the transportation budget is the faster registration fee and the gas tax. New Medicaid costs, we don't have much choice. You remember my proposal to limit nursing home days? No one's gonna go for that. We're not doing it. I'm trying to find a funny way to talk about Medicaid cuts. You can tell me if it's working or not. So we are paying for the new people that we need to pay for in Medicaid. We're transferring in a little bit of other money in other places, but those are the big ways we balance the 515 million. I saw a hand. Okay, great. Hi.
I've been working with probate court scamming going on in Colorado, and it's a national epidemic. I have been trying to get to the governor's office for 3 years, and I have many ways to cut the Medicaid costs if we stop these probate court people that turn our elderly people into guardianships and they steal all their property. This has been going all over Colorado. I get complaints every single day. And if we were to stop them, they would stop these wealthy families, including mine, who have lost millions of dollars, from going onto Medicaid in the first step. So how can I get to the governor? I mean, I tried. They have gatekeepers. I cannot get in there to talk to them about this. What do you recommend?
Well, I recommend that we learn about what you're talking about, because I agree with you that people cheating on Medicaid is one of the growing sources of our issue. Our most expensive category is the elderly and disabled. But they're the smallest in terms of the number of people on Medicaid. And the fastest growing section of our population is over 65. My wife is from Florida, and there are all these billboards of lawyers advertising how to get you onto Medicaid. And so not knowing all the things that you've tried to talk to us about, I'm nominally in support of cracking down as much as we can. We have a recovery section in our Medicaid division where they go and they recover costs where they can. But if people are hiding assets illegally, then we should look at that. I can get your contact information and learn more about what you're talking about. Don't forget, probate is in the judicial branch. And so we're not them. But if there's laws that we can work on together, that would help the state budget for sure.
Can I say something? Tuesday night I was at a meeting where we had, now we have Aurora police department, a special victims unit that deals with elderly being milked for money at that. And Detective Maddox is in charge of that unit. And that's for the Aurora area, because they receive complaints about caregivers taking money, using money, credit cards, and all that. So you may want to at least touch base with the Aurora Police Department on that area. It's a special victims unit, especially for elderly men and children.
The only problem is that I'm saying it's a civil issue.
So, Lewis, thank you for flagging that issue for everybody's benefit. I also just want to add on this subject before we move back to budget-related questions. The bunch of us got together last week to plan these town halls topics for the whole rest of the year, and one topic that we are going to address, we're going to do a whole panel, dedicate a whole evening, like we are this evening to the budget, to the issue of elder scams and fraud and abuse, because as Henry pointed out, it's a growing population. My father was born in 1946. That puts him on the very leading edge of the baby boom generation. So we will be addressing that head on in the course of this year.
Director, how much would that refund be?
At 20, 30 million? Well, the way the refund works is it's based on how much you earn and you file for it when you file your taxes. There's a range, and I think at that level it's going to be $6 or $7, maybe to $20. Not
Please.
Much. Senator Fields asked me to talk a little bit about the school budget and the property tax drop. So again, the property tax assessment rate on your house. So you have the value of your house, and then there's a rate that the state applies to it, a percentage. It's called the residential assessment rate. Right now it's 7.96%. So if your house is $100,000, $7,960 is what the mill levy applies to. That's gonna drop to 6.56%. So good news if you own a house, but no argument. But again, it takes us away from being able to keep up with enrollment and inflation at the state. It shifts a cost into the state. So when we do all the math, it's going to be $110 million or so that we don't have. And so we've proposed two things that are, one's popular, maybe one's not. So the senior homestead exemption, again, you get the first $200,000 of value, you get an exemption for that. Ed talked to me about that on the way in. So the voters allowed us to reduce that if we need to. We did twice before in the last two recessions. So we're proposing reducing that again to $100,000. That generates about $68 million. There's a program in there, though, that's for disabled seniors, or disabled veterans, excuse me. We're not reducing that. It's only the original program. And then the voters allowed us to raise marijuana special sales tax, not the tax that goes to the school construction, the sales tax that pays for the ads Lewis doesn't like. That can go up to 15%. Right now it's at 10. July 1st, if we leave everything alone, it'll fall to 8. We're proposing having it go back up to 12, go up to 12, and that'll generate $42 million. So 68 and 42 closes the property tax gap. Now, if we don't, that's $122 per kid across the whole state that the state won't be paying for. So this is really a terrible choice to have to make. But when you have a rule in the Constitution limiting what you can keep, a rule that takes away property taxes, and then a rule that says you have to grow your biggest budget, you're left with what the voters have let you do, and voters have let us, have given us permission to do those two things. Doesn't make it easy, but that's the choices we have. I saw several hands, there's a lot of fidgeting. Okay, sorry.
Yes, you mentioned that the assessment rate for residential would be dropping.
Yeah.
What about the non-residential? It's currently at 29%.
Correct.
So I had a friend just last night say that was rather unfair for people running businesses out of their garage, for example.
Yeah.
Any word on that? Is dropping that rate as well?
So no, the way the Gallagher law works is that the burden is meant to be fixed at where it was in 1985. And so the way we handle that is we only lower the residential assessment rate. So the the non-residential assessment rate is going to be at 29%. Now, on small business, there's some talk at the Capitol to work on some exemptions for business personal property tax for smaller businesses. A couple of years ago, we passed a bill where we go up to $15,000 and there's a state income tax credit of up to $15,000 of business personal property. That is on the books until 2020. So there's a little bit of relief for smaller businesses on the business personal property, maybe not on the building that they're using, but certainly on their equipment. Yes, businesses complain about this all the time, but I will tell you, Colorado, our economy is thriving relative to other parts of the country, so I'm not sure how much this is hurting us.
You said that the tax ratio, I think, for residential and non-residential has to be 45%, residential and 55%.
It's approximately 55-45, yeah.
And that was based on the figures of the
85.
Yeah. Is that still the case?
Well, they're out of whack now, and so the way to get them back into whack is to lower the residential assessment rate.
But is it still 45% residential?
Yeah.
Makes up the overall actual value of the land.
Correct. Yes, exactly correct. It's the 45% of the value. Because remember, mill levies are different everywhere, so it's not maybe the total burden, but it's the total value.
So if we increase the marijuana tax,
yes.
What is it going to go up to get that 122 to kids?
So if you, it's illegal to do it all with marijuana because we don't have enough. We only can go up to 15%.
Okay.
So from 8 to 12, which is what we proposed, it's about 10 million every point. So we proposed 4 points. It's going to give us about 42 million.
And what is the consequences?
What's the so there's some concern.
Black market.
Yeah. Will this stimulate the black market of marijuana? One issue is that there's more businesses selling marijuana now. There's more supply and the prices are lower than they were 2 years ago. So the impact of the tax increase won't be as big as it would have at the beginning. Secondly, we've asked for a local government fund to attack the gray market, which is home grows that are cheating, and the black market, which is the original drug dealer idea. So we've asked for local grant funds to help local governments deal with illegal grows and continuing illegal marijuana. So hopefully between the lower prices and hopefully you say yes to our request to help local governments, I'm lobbying on my spare time here, we can mitigate having the higher tax rate stimulate people to just go to their local provider.
Question over here. With all of the states that
yes.
Is that going to take away from some of the people coming here to spend money, so will be less tax?
I think that yes. All things equal, we think some people have used marijuana while they're here visiting. We don't know the percentage only coming just for that. Like, I have to have my vacation in Colorado. Marijuana was pretty prevalent before, and so it wasn't that hard to get anyway. So now it's kind of more in the open. I think prices will drop, I think, there might be a little bit of disruption. What I hope it really gets rid of is this illegal gray market stuff, where people are growing it here and taking it to other states. The more it's legal in other states, the less illegal activity we'll have here. I saw that one first up there. Thank you.
Why can't you talk about resetting the residential rate?
Okay, this is an amazing question. Thank you for that question. Why can't we talk about resetting the residential rate? We can, but many legal experts around the Tabor Law say that if we don't drop the residential assessment rate, we'll be out of compliance with Gallagher. And if we raise it to where it used to be, it might be considered an illegal tax increase that requires a vote of the people. So there's a little bit of debate about that. One option would be go to the voters and ask for higher property taxes. Is that what you're getting me to say? But I do want to emphasize, if you're not for the marijuana tax or the senior homestead, that's fine. Those are legal maneuvers for the state legislature. The voters have approved those changes before today. So those are in the realm of fair. and prior voter approval has already been given. They might not be what you want, and if you don't have a kid in school, that might be just, I don't care. I'm not here to pass judgment on that, but relative to what's allowed, those two moves are legal and allowed and have prior voter approval.
Could we possibly, I don't know how many of you know what the Gallagher Amendment is and how it interacts with Tabor.
Wow. Okay, let's do that. Can I use, do you guys mind if I use the whiteboard? Is that helpful?
We'll get out of your way. Right?
I'll, you guys can stay.
Okay. So, this is all of our land. And this is last year. So non-residential had a 55% share of the assessed value. And then resident had 45%. Are we on the trolley? So the total value of the land adds to 100. The assessed value for non-residential was 55 to 45. Now, we've had some very strange series of economic events. Oh, thank you. You guys are great. The oil and gas industry had a major downturn, and they are counted up in the non-residential. So this actually, strangely enough, in the assessment is falling. So it's down to like something like that. But our residential values have been surging. So if you've been paying attention to home values, on Zillow, how much is my neighbor's house worth? How much is mine? I forget what this one is, but to keep the 55-45 ratio, it's out of whack. So to get this back up to a 55, and this grew, we have to say the value is lower. And the way we do that is called the residential assessment rate. So right now, we multiply all this by 7.96, and we get the right amount. It's fair. Now, 7.96 is going to drop to like 6.56, if you read our budget letter, which you might have, based on all these great questions. I think 6.56 is the number. So, automatically, just by sitting there watching television, you're getting a 17.6% drop in your property taxes. And so, how that affects us is we have less money for local share for state education. And then another, so that's one part of the Constitution, takes away money for schools. And then a whole other section of it says you have to grow that budget. So, we call it the fiscal thicket. The rules don't make sense. They were put in the Constitution over 30 years with no plan. Like, 1982 is Gallagher. We want lower residential property taxes. Pretty popular. People voted yes. 1992, we want to vote on taxes. That's Tabor. There's a whole bunch of other stuff in Tabor. That was popular. It passed. And then Amendment 23 came in 2000. We want to protect funding for education, and all we need to do is just keep a little bit above Tabor. That's not what it said. It had this automatic growth factor that you have to pay for even if you don't have the cash. It passed. So, tax limitation, tax drops, mandatory spending, all in our Constitution. Representative, you said...
Can you repeat that again? Oh my goodness.
What I just said? Tax limitation, tax drops, mandatory spending, all in our Constitution. Yes, exactly correct. You might still have to pay a little bit more if your house went up a lot. What we're working on is we thought 7.96 was going to stay 7.96. So we're short what we thought we were going to have from expectation. And when you have to grow the budget, now we're further behind.
But you can have a lot more coming in than you really know.
No, we know what we're going to get because we have all the values and we're looking ahead. Yeah.
So we're getting a little bit, but we're getting less than we expected. Okay. Can someone read?
I'm going to try.
Okay. All right.
She's saying, don't forget the 6.56% also affects fire, parks, and rec, et cetera, and distracts the county and city too. So they are less fun.
So we have an opening for budget analysts.
Yeah, exactly.
Wow. I was about to mention that, and you're a step ahead of me. So when I said what I'm worried about, it's because I'm the state budget director and I have the big blue slice keeping me up at night. Local governments also rely on residential property taxes to pay for the services you just read out loud. So water district, fire district, parks and rec. I live in Denver, so my bills are pretty small compared to, I used to live in Centennial, and there's all kinds of stuff because there's a special fire district. There's a park district. You know, in Denver, we have the police, we have Denver Public Schools, but then the city provides a lot of the stuff where there's special mill levies in some of the other counties around Denver. So there's more to come from the impact of this residential assessment rate dropping. And if you're in a slow-growing part of the state where you haven't had crazy growth, and oh my God, I can't believe my house is worth this much, this is really going to leave a mark on those local districts. Someone who hasn't asked, Ed?
I was just wondering, in those school districts where the federal government has installations, like military installations, do those school districts still get money from the federal government in lieu of taxes?
Wow, okay.
That used to be the case.
Yeah, there's a payment in lieu of taxes program in some parts of the state.
I imagine it would be pretty big here in Aurora, this Aurora School District, with Buckley Air Force Base.
I don't know if the kids of the Buckley workers or airmen and women go to a special school.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, I don't think so.
But the federal government does not pay taxes, you know, property taxes on the land where the base is located.
But the people have to live. The homes, they're not living on the base.
There is
the
some base, but not comparable to the number of employees
on the base. I think most governments don't pay property
tax. Yeah, federal government, but they used to pay in lieu of taxes.
Yes, I agree, and I'm just not up to speed on that right now.
There is an impact fee, but it only relates to those people who live on the base.
Oh, got it.
And right now it's maybe 40 families.
Okay.
So the impact is minor. You got to remember, most of the people that are stationed out at Buckley, I tell you from the experience, I moved around as an Air Force guy myself. I lived on the economy most of the time, so I was paying the same taxes as everybody else was. So the only time that impact fee comes into play is when you have people living on the base and there's children going to school from the base to the local schools. And the local schools do get an impact fee for that.
Yeah, it used to be pretty big in most places.
Before the next question, I just want to say thank you for coming out. I think anyone willing to give up their, you know, night for this. You know, this is what I do all night. I don't sleep anyway, so I'm here. You guys coming out to hear and meet your representatives, I really think it's exactly what America is all about. So I'm just very impressed, and thank you for coming out.
Thank you.
I just want to thank you again, Henry, for taking time after already a long day. And to Henry's point, so some of us have attended town halls in the past as citizens before we chose to run and become elected and sit in our field system, many of these as a representative. I will say, having been at probably at least 100 of these over the years, we have just gone to the absolute heart of what it is to run government in Colorado. This is extremely advanced. As a wise person once said to me when I started a new job years ago, if you're confused, it's not you, it's because things are confusing. Henry started out by saying that Colorado, like every other state, has to pass a balanced budget. A lot of everything else we talked about here, Tabor, Gallagher, Amendment 23, SB 228, et cetera, no other state has. It is probably harder to wade through the set of laws that relate to passing a budget every year. in Colorado than in every other state in the country. Henry as a budget director, and he's been doing this for near on 20 years, I think.
Not quite, but close, yeah.
has not an enviable job, and frankly, I think we as citizens, it's harder on us to wade through and sort all of this out. So I do want to thank everybody for coming out and sticking with all of this. What we were going to do now is, because all of us are new in our positions, we were going to take just a few minutes. We've talked about the budget. We'll start with Senator Fields. She can say a little bit. Okay. We'll go the other way. Just so that Rep. Jackson and Rep. Michaelson Jenet can take a few minutes to tell you about what other things they're going to be working on. We all have to start with the budget together, but then we all have individual bills. Carolyn, you did have your hand up, so quick question.
She needs a
mic. That have done, have excluded Tabor, have deep-rooted,
yeah.
As the term is. There are 50 counties in the state that have deep-rooted. One of them is only like for an open space, and that was Arapahoe County. But the other ones are for everything. So is there any further discussion about the possibility of putting it to the voters to de-Tabor?
Great question. All but four school districts have de-bruised as well. Our argument is as follows on the Tabor issue for the state. The design of the hospital fee program is the reason we're at the limit. And there was a different way of designing the hospital fee program where we wouldn't be at the limit. So the voters gave us a generous timeout in referendum C, and you can see the line here being adjusted. We're still not recovered from the impact of the Great Recession. Every other source of funds, if you add it all up, this is an important point, I know I'm cutting into your guys' time and I'm sorry, is below population and inflation growth since the end of the Great Recession. What that line means is the entire rest of state government, and it's true in the general fund, we're actually lower when you adjust for population and inflation in the general fund than in 2008. So, we have the radical idea of we'd like to keep the money that we have and account for this program in a separate pot of money. Attorney General says it's legal to do, and we can't get it through the state Senate. So that's a little bit of a negative note to end on, but I don't think Tabor's the problem. I think when you can't keep what you have and you have automatic spending in the Constitution, if this was a friend of yours, you would take him to rehab.
Oh, Dominique, start singing, I'm going to rehab, go ahead.
Thank you very much. You guys are awesome.
Yeah.
Give yourselves a round. So, a little bit about what we're working on. There is somebody that came up to me today at the Capitol, a citizen, and was like, hi, nice to meet you. How long have you been a legislator? And I'm like, I don't know. It's been, I don't know, how many days?
Six, eight,
exactly. So it's incredible. It's exciting. It's invigorating. We have a lot of work to do. A couple of things that I'm working on. I have introduced, most of us freshman members of the House, we get to introduce bills originally a little bit later than folks who had already been there before, partially because it's all new to us. So I have one bill that has been introduced, and that bill deals with the rights of victims of sexual assault and stalking when it comes to their ability to break their residential leases. There is already a statute in regards to victims of domestic violence that allows them to do so. And so this is simply adding the same protections to victims of sexual assault and stalking. And we're also, the bill also asks to offer up other ways in which a person can prove that they have been a victim of sexual assault and stalking for this purpose. Please know there are still protections for landlords. Victims still have to give a landlord 30 days notice, and pay months worth of rent, and landlords still have their rights as far as they're concerned in regards to damage deposits and whatnot. This is a piece of legislation that came to me. There have been partially from knocking on doors and partially from some nonprofit organizations. It is an issue that has been, that people who have been associated with some nonprofits, including the Colorado Association, or CCASA, Colorado Association, or
Coalition Against Sexual Assault.
Thank you, Coalition Against Sexual Assault. I'm getting all my acronyms messed up. And the Colorado Coalition Against Domestic Violence. It has been their number one priority from their membership for many years. And so my email's been blowing up all day, getting a lot of people and a lot of organizations that are very supportive of this piece of legislation. We're hoping that this is, you know, not gonna be a partisan issue. One of the other things that I'm working on, which is a priority for, I would say, both chambers, and it has some bipartisan support, I'm happy to say, is a affordable housing bill.
Yeah.
Woo! And it is something that is going to impact people in every corner of our state. So that bill has not been introduced, but hopefully it will be relatively soon, and I'm so anxious to share the details with you once that happens, but of course we have to iron out those details first. So that's what I'm working on.
So a couple bills that I'm working on. The first one that I'm going to share with you, I was very honored to have been included in the Speaker of the House's initial four bills that were introduced that set the priority for our State House for this year. And that is a bill that will directly impact veterans and their success should they choose to go to school following their service or at any time post service when they choose to use their GI Bill. Right now, when you get your GI Bill, you can go to any institution and provide them with your experience, and they may or may not give you credit for it. Other states have utilized a statewide metric so that all state institutions value the joint military transcript equally. We are going to hopefully pass. We have some good bipartisan support already. A measure to adopt that metric so that our veterans know where they stand and that we are opening up the welcome mat for them. The other thing you need to know about the GI Bill, if you are not a veteran or if you know a veteran, is that it runs out in 36 months. And so what's been happening is our veterans will come back and they will be put in, they'll decide they want to go to school, and we're going to make them take classes that they already took while they were in service for their job or for their promotions. And they get frustrated, understandably, and so they drop out or they drop that class and they don't know to hit pause on their GI Bill, and then their GI Bill runs out. So we are setting up veterans for a cycle of failure once they come back, because we haven't honored the experience we've, by the way, already paid for as taxpayers while they were trained in the military. So we don't want to pay for those same classes over and over again, and we don't want to set our veterans up for failure. We're very excited about it. It should be, it's already been read across. It should go into committee next week, early next week. So we'll keep you posted on that one. And my other bill that I just spent a good part of today working on is directly impacting youth corrections. Today I went and toured our Lookout Mountain facilities that are under youth correction. We have 738 youth in our state that are currently in youth corrections, and trying to look at, you know, when you're a youth and you become incarcerated, part of the program is school. And what can we be doing while you are incarcerated to make sure you're getting all of the skill sets you need to be successful when you leave incarceration? There have been significant culture shifts in our youth correctional facilities over the last several years. We want to take it one step further to make sure that our youth come out of the correction system and never return. So again, just like Representative Jackson said, this is something that we're still ironing out all of the details on so that we pass some legislation that makes sense as opposed to creates a redundancy. And I look forward to hopefully serving our youth. I look at our correctional facilities as the most expensive boarding school in the state, and they're my kids that are at this school, and you better believe as a mom, I'm gonna fight for every dollar I'm paying for those kids to be in school to get the best education they can and to serve our community when they are released.
Very briefly, the first bill that I have introduced, I expect it to come up in committee next week, relates to veteran service organizations and their ability to host community service when somebody who's committed a low-level criminal offense is sentenced to do community service. Right now, essentially, our law excludes some categories of veteran service organizations. I think George and I talked about this morning. Try not to get too wonky, but essentially, a veteran service organization might be set up under any of three common provisions of the federal tax code. One of the three is included, the other two, including some big ones like American Legion, are excluded. The intent of the bill is simply that everybody should have a chance to benefit from where somebody has to do community service. And you know, if the point of this type of sentencing is for somebody to pay their debt and then maybe not reoffend, I think the discipline of military community is not a bad influence to have there. So I have been talking to members of both parties, and I'm pretty optimistic about how that one's going to go. Some other issues I'm continuing to work on relate to homeowners associations. When we had one of these town halls on that topic, literally the fire marshal has had to come and almost shut us down. A lot of folks have a fine experience with their HOA and plenty don't. So I'm going to be looking at fees that some of those associations charge and issues about how the boards are controlled. And really, if you own any home, particularly if you are an HOA, that is your biggest asset that you have, very likely. And to me, an HOA is an instance of a government, and like any government, it needs to be accountable and it needs to respect the rights of people who live in it, and it needs to be judicious with the money that it is asking for. So that's the intent there. Some other issues I'm continuing to research include campaign finance reform. We just came through a nasty election. Sometimes you get a piece of mail or you see something on TV or whatever. You might see who it's paid for. You don't always. Under the current state of what the Supreme Court has said about campaign finance, our hands are tied pretty tight. It's hard for us to get a lot of money out of the system, but we can try to do more to say that you at least have the right to know who's putting the mail in your box or the ad on your TV, so you can look that entity up and do some homework and decide what weight you want to assign it. So I'm optimistic that we'll have some good transparency bills there. Also gonna continue to do some work on how we conduct our elections. Colorado had, I think, the third highest turnout of any state in the country.
Thank you.
The point of democracy is that everybody participates, and then the winner or loser is determined by robust participation. We have a very good system. We're going to try to continue to improve it. We'll also be looking at employment law, potentially, and notifications that individuals may be entitled to receive if there's going to be a layoff situation. That's still very much in process. Finally, just to get back to some of the big things that Henry mentioned, and I'm sure that we all heard this as we walked around, education and transportation. One of the fundamental things schools should be doing is educating our kids. Henry talked about the cut per student. What I don't think you said is how low we already are, which is 43rd out of 50 states, if you rank them. This is the number one concern that I heard in the course of spending 18 months visiting folks in Aurora. And we all love getting around in rush hour anymore, so we're all going to be looking at that. I want to be respectful of everybody's time. I think we're coming up on 8:30, so I'll hand it back to Senator Fields here.
That's right. So I'll wrap things up. But let's give our brand new representative a hand. We have a very strong delegation. So there's a couple of folks that are not here. Javon Mountain is hosting an event down in Denver.
member. He's not here. Of course, we also have Senator Nancy Todd. She represents Aurora. We also have Daniel Kagan, who represents a portion of Aurora. We also have Jan2017 Buckner, representing Aurora. So we have a very strong presence, and I can tell you that we're all have our sleeves rolled up. Our bootstraps are wrapped up and laced up, and we're ready to fight for the values that are important to all of us. To find out about what I'm running, you're going to have to come back next session, the next town hall meeting, which is going to be the third Thursday in February, and the topic has already been identified, and it's going to be about know your rights. Know your rights as it relates to a senior who may be a victim of some kind of fraud or cyber fraud or some kind of fraud. We want you to know your rights as a student. We want you just to know your basic civil rights and how to claim those rights and exercise your rights when you need to. So we're going to have a strong panel dealing with that topic. You'll be hearing about it on Facebook and wherever we might post the information, but we do want to thank you for your time, and let's thank the director.
Yeah.
Thank you all for being here.
He wants a picture.
See you
a little later.
Sure.
Wants a picture.
Yes.
One last note for everybody who'd like to follow along in our legislative session that just started. I wrote this website on the board. It's leg.colorado.gov. That is the newly redesigned state legislative website.
It has a great mobile app.
It works on a smartphone. You can see video when we are all on the floor. You can stream audio from a committee. You can see the calendar, what bills are up in what committee on what days. You can see what's called a status sheet, which is a concise listing of everything and where it is in the legislative process. You can search by topics. If you're interested in bills on the budget, for example, you can find those bills. If you're interested in education bills, you can search that way. They literally just relaunched this website a week or two ago, and it's more modern than before that you can do to navigate the process in a day.
Thank you, sir.
Looking over there.